Greetings, brothers and sisters. I'm Professor Spira, and welcome to question and answer number 6. And getting a lot of great feedback about these live question and answer sessions that a lot of folks are enjoying what we talk about, kind of addressing some of these issues as they come up, as people are working through some of these things to actually discuss them, talk about them. seemed to be helpful for a lot of people. Let's see, got a technical thing going on here. I was hearing a 30-second delay feedback of what I was just saying, like 30 seconds later. But so hope all of you are doing well. And unfortunately, Tony couldn't be here on this one. I enjoy having him here on these, but he's working, doing some taking care of his school work, and I know what that's like. Myself is trying to gotta finish up my own dissertation and graduate with my PhD in ethnomusicology. Sometime I'd like to talk more about that kind of thing, music. That's something, a topic that I would actually like to get to a little bit more, talking about the connection between meditation and music, kind of my own personal meditation and practices that are just very unorthodox in terms of what it, you know, it's not like a standard ritualized thing that is some established thing, but something that I've kind of developed in a new way, or at least it's a way of looking at that whole process of tapping into higher levels of consciousness using very natural and basic tools. You know, as humans are musical beings. they say we're social beings. We're musical beings. That's why everybody has a type of music that they like, and everybody has the ability to make music on certain levels. And once you become a controller of vibration, of sound and vibration, then you are able to tap into things, manipulate things, raise your consciousness depending on what kind of music. You know, there are a lot of forms of music that sort of correlate with the carnal side of life and the lower levels of things. A lot of pop music kind of has that tendency, you know, is dealing with appetites of the flesh, as it were, with the, everything from sex to greed and money and lust and gluttony and everything else, which is what it is. It's an expression, music and art is nothing more than expression of one's physiological consciousness, as far as I'm concerned. And so it's not that people always say, well, it's the music that's doing it. The kids are listening to, all that bad music. I'm like, well, then I guess we can't listen to Wagner, because Hitler was into Wagner. So I guess that must be some terrible music. You know, it's not the music. It's about the expression. You know, music tells a story of your physiology, of what's going on. You know, so I can listen to music, and me and Brother Air do this, where we'll listen to music and we can tell you what the person is eating that's making that music. And you can actually get into a study of physics based on that, because you can get into studying the way in which sound and vibration resonates off of a particular body. And the kind of sound and vibration that's going to be inspired and to emanate from a particular person or body. You know, that a lot of these different kinds of music, I think, you know, theoretically or philosophically, kind of stem from these various levels of consciousness and various levels of physiological consciousness. I think I coined a new term just now, physiological consciousness. Which is, I think that's a good concept. We can get into that, because it all has to be connected to me. To me, the whole there's no use in disconnecting the concept of consciousness from physiology. And I know that's the tendency, and that's the sort of the tradition and what a lot of people do I think is to make them feel better about it. It's kind of like, okay, well, you can do work on your physiology and body, but it's really not that important because it's just all about consciousness. But your physiology is connected to your consciousness, or at least that's been my experience and what I've seen, because when I improve my physiology, my consciousness immediately raises. It doesn't always work the other way around. It doesn't always necessarily raise your consciousness, and then you find yourself wanting to improve your physiological prowess. It happens sometimes, but it's not always, you know, it's not always a hand in glove like that. So I think it's best to sort of think about them in tandem. But a little bit, I'm going to talk a little bit about the GoFundMe campaign. Oh, we got one more day with that. This was the fundraiser to raise money to be able to produce the audiobook. And I really, really appreciate everybody's support and everybody's love that has been poured out. And, we reached our initial goal fairly quickly. And then, I kind of raised the bar a little bit and we got more, because that kind of enables me. I kind of lowballed it because I didn't know how, how much support I'd be able to get or not. And I didn't want to do something crazy. But then as it was coming in, it's like, okay, well, now I can really be able to, get it disseminated properly, because that takes money. So there's a lot of money that goes into just the whole process of producing something like this and then putting it out there. And so, I'm real happy that I will be able to do that. Not just, that's all of you. Just got to thank you guys for all the support, and believing in me and believing in the vision that we all have, that this diet can change the world, and it's going to change it in a different way than what people think. Everybody likes to imagine, well, what's the change going to look like? And I'm saying change is already happening. The transition is on, but it's a transition. So it's not like a billion people learning about this at one time. People are being transitioned into the consciousness, getting themselves mentally and in some ways physiologically ready for this transition, because this isn't playing games. This is not a sandbox-based dietary healing system. This is very, very serious and mature system, because there's things that you have to let go of, or you will be challenged to let go of certain mores, certain concepts, certain nutritional theories, or certain, whatever. All that stuff is challenged. And like nothing else, you will be confronted with yourself, where you had to look in the mirror and deal with yourself. Like, okay, who, what, and when am I? And where am I? And a lot of people have trouble doing that. A lot of people do not want to be honest with themselves, look in the mirror and say, okay, I'm a mucus addict, I'm filthy, but I'm doing everything in my power to get myself together. That's a hard being, as we are so addicted to mucus forming foods. That's not an easy, task. And there's a lot of self-love. I mean, you had to learn how to really love yourself, because you have to know that you are, you got to kind of know who you are. And, a lot of people use this path to find that out. There are, like, I was on a path of trying to find out who and what I was and what humanity is, and that led me to the mucus's diet path, and that opened up a whole different thing, because there is a lot more to this process. I mean, we focus on the stuff that when we talk, and I know sometimes people are like, oh, you talk about transition, all that kind of stuff. Well, there's a lot of other stuff we get into, but lots of times people don't, for whatever reason, they don't like those discussions, or those discussions don't get as much views. We talk, you know, philosophical analysis of Plato's The Cave and, you know, that kind of, you know, some of those things that I think would really be interesting, and for people, they don't necessarily gravitate to that stuff, which is fine. But the one thing that everybody needs to be talking about is transition. And so that's my talking point. That's, I'm always just come back to that, because it's more than just diet. And it's so much more. I mean, you're dealing with an entire, I mean, transition is life, really. You know, I mean, that's how serious understanding that is, and the nuances of it, because there's so many levels to transition. So let me get to some of these questions here. And this is a question from Michelle. This was posted on the Arnold Eric forum, and I thought this was a real good question. It says, higher up, asking about, you eat cooked vegetables, this kind of thing. And then down here, let's see, I color coded this funny. I should, let me look at it on the, put a weird color coding on it that's making it hard for me to kind of see. But, okay. So the question for me is, how can raw foodists or strict fruit veggie only eaters or fruitarians who have never transitioned properly utilize the mucus's diet healing system? If all the transitional cooked mucusless and mucus lean foods have been non-existent in the diet for a long period of time, how should they be reintroduced? I realize that I may be nuking this and the answer is staring me right in the face. It's like, it's actually a great question, because I work with a lot of people that are coming from 80-10-10, or coming from, you know, kind of had been working on Dr. Morris's protocols, or, you know, just general raw foodists, you know, Gabriel Cousins or whatever, you know, and I get a lot of folks coming from these raw foodist communities, and they kind of hit a wall, and it's a wall that they see that I'm talking about that wall. Like, and you look at all my blog posts, you look at one of my main message of transition, that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about there comes a time when transition is inevitable and the need to take a step back is necessary. And that step back can be rational, it can be methodical, and it can help you later take a bigger step forward. But you have to have a little method to the madness. And that's where a lot of the raw food folks don't have that. They don't have a system in place that when you hit a wall physiologically and you can't go any further from where you're at, or some kind of weaknesses come up that you can't deal with just eating more fruit, you know, or drinking more water for more days, you know, like sometimes that's just not going to cut it. That sometimes you need to slow down the elimination, take a step back, and then find a plateau point there, you know, and then take another leap forward. And so in terms of getting into a mucusless diet healing system protocol, say from just a straight, say you've been on nothing but grapes for 2 or 3 months, I would say what I did when I've done several fairly long fasts. I don't talk about them much because I don't want people thinking that they're supposed to be doing them kind of fast. I'd rather talk about Brother Ayer's fast or something, but I've also done long fast. And what I did, I've done several 6-month long juice fasts. And I would, and those were raw, you know. And so I would spend almost 2 months, 2 to 3 months transitioning back into solid food. So, and I use the same transitional principles of the mucus's diet. It's just I'm looking at it and I'm kind of analyzing and saying, okay, if all I was doing was drinking juice for this long period of time, then what do I do? And I went through a period where the line between fasting and the line between eating solid food was kind of blurred. So I would maybe, where I maybe didn't have any pulp in the juice, I would start putting a little pulp. You know, I did a lot of orange juice and stuff at that point. And so I would maybe add a little bit of pulp to it for a while. Then I kind of got into a short period of smoothies. I'm not a huge fan of smoothies, but it kind of started to get my system used to that solid food again. Then eventually I got to a point where I was eating, you know, I might eat a couple grapes, but then I was still juicing. I was still drinking juice, or, you know, apple juice or whatever. And so I allowed the process to unfold. And then, you know, far enough down the line, I finally introduced solid food. Now that's what I developed in terms of breaking a long-term fast. That's not how you break a short-term fast. Or that's not how you break a fast within the context of Arnold Arendt in like rational fasting or mucus diet healing system, where you're supposed to sort of eat enough food to create that bowel movement. You want, after a 2 or 3 day fast in normal circumstances, you don't want to be meager with breaking your fast. Like it's not about trying to be restrictive when you break the fast. You want to break it with the right food items. So most people should break it with fruit. If you're just getting into the diet and you're coming from a meat kind of diet or a standard American diet or something, you can break it with vegetables, with a vegetable meal. But in general, the higher level breaking is going to be with some fruit. But in terms of the reason I'm saying all this is because that same idea can be applied to transitioning into cooked foods if you've been off of them for so long. You want to go after the foods that are going to be the easiest on your system. So something like, you know, Eric always talks about the stewed fruit, the baked fruit, and getting in some baked banana or baked apple or something like that. It's very gentle on the system. You should have no problem digesting it. Now, granted, you have to spend a little bit of time sort of reacclimating yourself to that level, because I'm not going to lie to you and say like, oh, wow, it's, you know, the eating level is just as great. And so it's like, after you've experienced the fruit levels and the fasting levels, it is taking a step back. You know, it's not going to feel the greatest, but what do we have to pay? Think about what we have, the karma we have built up from years of dead animal flesh eating and years of whatever we've done in the past, that kind of stuff. Think about how much karma we have to deal with. So we're not always going to be comfortable. This path is not about always being comfortable and always feeling 100% brilliant all the time. You know, this is about, in some ways, I mean, it's about struggle. It's about detox. It's about transition. It's about really transforming your body, mind, and spirit on all levels. And so, in many cases, some of this process isn't always going to feel, 100% wonderful, but it's necessary. You know, I would love to, you know, there's just no shortcuts. Believe me, if I could just stop eating mucus tomorrow and eating cooked food or whatever, if I could just be on nothing but fruit, if I was clean enough to do that or be on nothing but juices or water or whatever, like if I could just do that for the rest of time, I would. But I understand and have experienced how deep the addiction is, how filthy I am physiologically, and how long it takes to really make these changes. And so it's just not a good idea to try to rush, because I don't want to hold anybody back. If whatever your goals are, if your goal is to be raw, your goal is to be whatever, that's great. You know, my main message is, for me, mucusless is more important than raw, you know, in terms of if there's a focus of something to stay away from versus something to move toward, I'd rather be eating mucus-free vegetables than eating mucus-forming raw vegetables and fruit, you know. But that's just me. I practice Mucus's Diet Healing System. That's what I do. So that's where I'm coming from. But as far as the as far as the transition, I mean, I would say check out your baked fruits maybe at the beginning. Then when you get to vegetables, something like the baked zucchini. But here's the thing: anytime you have a cooked vegetable, always have a raw salad with it. So anytime you have any kind of cooked vegetables, just have the raw salad with it. So something like baked zucchini is, because it's real light, it's already not very starchy. So, you know, you bake it and it's very easy to digest and it eliminates fairly well. Something like I don't really like it, but Brother Air used to get into steamed spinach, which and you don't have to steam it long. I mean, if you got some steam going, you can put it in there for about 30 seconds, a minute, and it's totally ready. And that's very light and easy on the intestine. But again, you always want to combine it with the raw salad, because that's going to create that intestinal broom and get things moving. So my main thing with that is just transition back in. You don't have to have these big cooked meals. Just have mostly raw and add one, like Aaron said, you really shouldn't have more than one cooked vegetable if you're having some cooked items involved. You know, throw in baked zucchini or some steam. Broccoli is going to be a little harder. I'll maybe wait on the broccoli kind of things. Because, you know, my favorite stuff in general is like the steamed broccoli and steamed collard greens and that kind of stuff. But that's a little bit harder to digest, you know, even when it's cooked a little bit. So I would go with the, some of those like summer squash, zucchini, that kind of thing, you know, some stuff that's really going to, eliminate fairly well and combine well with that. But it's definitely doable. There's been a lot of folks that have made that jump, that found that they hit the wall with the raw food piece. And, philosophically, it's great. But in most cases, they leave out the mucusless principle to the point where they don't even sometimes talk about it. And then they sort of, have people find themselves that since they're not focused on the mucus addiction, when things hit the wall, then they start getting strung out on a bunch of avocados, a bunch of nuts and seeds, you know, so on and so forth. Again, these things are cool for the transition, but you don't want to be comfortable eating those things, you know, in terms of like in the way that I wouldn't want to be comfortable eating processed vegan food. You know, it's not a sin. You're not gonna die, in most cases you're not gonna die if you take a step back and eat something like that. And my technique with the diet has always been transform my physiology so that when I do take a step back, there's only so far I can go back without making myself deathly ill. So there's things that I've never you know, you say never say never, but at least in this condition, I'm not going back to some stuff ever again. But I have a handful of things that I will go back to that I know are bad. And that's fine to me. You know, it's a transition. This is about a long-term process. So you could go back to something. You might go back to something once a year. So what if you ate processed vegan foods? You had one soy burger a year. But the other part of the year, you're doing your raw mucus list. You're doing, you know, three month long fruit fast, fruit juice fasting, water fast. I mean, you're practicing the system, and then for one week or one weekend, just based on some physiological stuff or whatever, you get off into something like that. Who cares? You know, the main thing that makes you different from anybody else that does that is you have a system and a methodology. There's a method to what you're doing. And that's what nobody else has. Nobody else has a methodology that will give you that much latitude to be able to say, like, if you have to take that step back that far, take a step back that far. If you have to go further back, it's all about the transition. So you're never... It's never like, okay, you're out the club or something, like I know they do on some of the raw food groups are kind of cutthroat, because it's kind of like, you know, you talk about raw foods and it's like you're out the group, you know, or you know, they're kind of throwing you out, like I used to see that in a couple years ago. I'd started seeing that, and I just didn't, you know, I don't understand it in terms of that's just not my vibe. That's not something. It's not like if somebody doesn't believe what I believe, that I'm just going to kick them out of my groups, you know, or I just that's just not my vibe. But I'm an advocate of good discussion, you know, kind of good dialogue. If things get mean or people get mean or take personal shots or attacks, and that's when we're having a discussion about, you know, that kind of thing is not tolerated. But in terms of good old fashioned objective discussion, because and that's a challenge I know just for people sometimes, because these things get real emotional for people, you know, and passionate, because we're all passionate people. You know, trying to get ourselves together, trying to go down this path. And sometimes it just looking up and seeing how bad things were and how much we have been lied to and how we have been taught to be ignorant, that we've basically been conditioned to be ignorant, to not ask certain questions. Because like I say, the thing I always try to get people to do is, again, don't believe me. Just look up the history for yourself. Look up these, challenge these concepts, because I love challenging concepts. Let's challenge a protein theory. Let's challenge a nutrition theory. Let's look at the context in which these ideas were developed, and let's critique them. You know, very few people have done that, because they have taken these theories as law when they're not laws, they're theories. And a lot of them are fairly new theories, and they're bad, and they're pretty fallacious when you look at them, you know. So anyway, hopefully that answers that a little bit. And so, you know, it's just about the transition. It's the same. It's basically like the same thing that I would tell someone that's trying to get off of meat, where you just, you know, gradually do it. And before you know it, your physiology would change to the point where you can be off it. You know, it's the same thing with kind of transitioning back into a more standard kind of mucusless diet. You just have to do it gradually and do it slowly, and understand that every point of the way is not going to feel 100% great. But again, all the more that you combine it with the raw, you don't have to have a ton of cooked stuff. Just a little bit here and there. It evens things out, balances things out, slows down the elimination, and you're good to go. And like I said, that's the methodology where, like, the raw to four people, I just call that's the raw till transition, people. I call that raw till transition, because that's all that is. That's classic Mucus's diet. Eat fruit for fruit most of the day, or fruit for an afternoon meal and juices, and then have, you know, cooked meal at night that combines cooked and raw. But we're focused on, does it eliminate good? And how much mucus forming things in there. You know, I hear stories of some of those folks getting into rice and, you know, big things of rice or vegan pizza or all that kind of stuff. I'm like, you know, again, transitionally, there's better choices. There's way better choices. You know, so that becomes my thing. And so I'm not saying, well, that's just, that's crazy. It's like, no, it's just there's no methodology with that. And there's no understanding and consciousness of the detriment of mucus forming foods, you know, and that rice is probably one of the worst things that you could select as a transitional item. I don't recommend using rice to transition. You know, it's a very particular circumstances. In general, that's not going to be what you want to use. There's better options, that eliminate better, that fill you up just as good, that taste better to me, that has more. Rice don't taste like nothing unless you put some kind of seasonings or something on it. I mean, it's just like this little gluey little thingies, glue pellets. But so that's that. So let's move on to another question. This is from Amber. What can you do for bread cravings? My family buys breads and it's hard to avoid. I don't have an oven to bake sweet potato, but I can steam veggies. Also, what is good for boredom eating? So my thing, I'm with the bread. So there's two trains of thought. Okay, so here's Mucus's diet bread logic. Always, if you have the craving, always select some kind of 100% grain bread that is, like, you can get the Ezekiel bread with the sprouted wheat and all that. That's kind of what the standard bread is among a lot of mucus diet practitioners. It's what I use and stuff. But always toast it really well. So there's other videos you could probably find where we talk about well toasted wheat bread or burnt toast or whatever. And that is like, and here's why I air it focused on that and said, like, this would be a good thing for you to use, because you cook out the gluey properties. It's still mucus forming. Not saying it's not mucus forming, but it's way better than eating it not cooked, eating a piece of white bread, eating, you know, that kind of thing. And when combined properly with the combination salad, because again, this is where you get into that technique. You don't want to eat the bread first and then the salad. You eat a bunch of the salad, eat some of your cooked veggies, and then you eat a piece of toast if you still crave it at the end. And that is, again, methodology. Those are the little things of the transition, the little changes that you can make that can ultimately really transform your trajectory of the direction of your transition and make things a lot easier, you know. But it's just these little things, you know. Don't drink while you're eating. If you're going to have some toast, eat it after you have the vegetable meal. You know, if you're going to have fruit and vegetables in the same meal, always eat the fruit first, then wait for a period of time and eat the vegetable portion. These are just they're like the little guidelines, but they really make up a strong methodology when you look at them and really take it seriously and adhere to those principles. So in terms of like, you know, bread cravings, I would say you combine that. So that's on one hand, you can eat that with your vegetable meal, and over time you end up transitioning away from it, because if you're practicing the system, you know, you do some enemas, if you're into that, you do your enemas. You have your fasting days, if you do 2 to 3 day fast, which always breaks everything up. So no matter what you're addicted to, if you're like, okay, this weekend, like, enough's enough, I need to fast this weekend, and then you clear the time, have a space, and just be, you want to be in an environment that is emotionally stable and is possible, because sometimes you can get emotionally fragile because you're going through that, laying on nature's operating table. So, you know, if you have a couple days and you just fast and just kind of do what you need to do, then you come up out of that and you're like, okay, then you transition back into the heavier meals. So that's the key of the transition. It's always sort of changing up. So you're not going to get into a mode where you're eating this one thing for this extended period of time. It doesn't happen like that if you're practicing the system properly. You break it up. And that's what's really necessary to break up the addiction, because you hit some days of juice, or you hit a low fast, or you do some days mucusless when you feel able to, and you don't have to stay in one place forever. So my approach is, instead of trying to be so monolithic with the transition and say, like, I am off of, like, next week I will be off of bread, this will be my last piece of bread that I ever eat, like, instead of doing that, it just, I'd say eat one piece of bread per week, and then get a cut, you know, 2 or 3 day fast in, and get your all, you know, your vegetables in, or have a couple days where you eat nothing but fruit, and just work the system. You know, the system works if you work it, as they say. And so if you really get in deep into the system, you will systematically cleanse yourself, and you will want and crave bread less and less. Now, you want to take the transition to the next level with the bread. Then you graduate to the 100% grain tortillas, which are really thin. It's like those round tortillas. You put those in the oven for a few minutes, and they'll get kind of crispy. And that's a transitional step above the toast, because that eliminates even better, and it's less of it. But it, once you get to that point where that's satiating, then, you know, you put some salad on top of it or whatever, and you're using that. You know, and then again, like I said, you get to the stages where you don't even want that anymore, where it's like, I don't want that. You know, you want to be mucusless. And it's easy to be mucusless for periods. But again, you don't have to be monolithic. You don't have to be like, yes, I've been mucusless for a month, I will never go back to whatever. It's like, that's not the mentality, in my opinion. You know, it's better to say, I'm mucusless for a month. You know, like cool. And then if you're working the system, you know, it's not going to, it's not good to be mucusless for a month and then fall back and eat a bunch of mess. You're at least going to transition yourself back into eating some other things. So it's a new way to think, you know, it's just a different way to think about this thing where there's less pressure. You don't have to have all this pressure. It's like, let the system work for you, as opposed to trying to think about this stuff all the time and upset, because this is what we're talking about. You know, so we're talking about the diet, we're talking about the transition, but it's not something, it's not like it's supposed to occupy every moment of your mind and your being and stuff. It's like, it's like practicing anything else. Once you get it together, you know, and you understand and you learn these things, you don't have to think about it anymore. And it's like, I'm playing a keyboard over here. I you know, I spent years practicing and things and stuff, but like right now I'm not thinking, well, what I just did, I just improvised that. I'm not thinking about it. Sorry, I can get see what happens, you know, I get into music and I get lost in some stuff. See, now, because now, see, now what, see, what, look what you did. Now I got stuff in my head that I want to play. I didn't, you know, I spent years practicing to get to the point where I could do that, where I could just turn to a keyboard and just start, you know, just kind of just flying around doing some things. Now, there's a lot of stuff that I need to practice if I want to get better and if I want to work on a particular song or a particular idea or, you know, or a new thing. You know, I'm working on these minor third. You know, it's just, anyway, if you know music, you know, minor third things. But I'm, you know, working on that kind of stuff. And so I will slow that down and practice that and practice it every day. But you practice enough in the beginning so that down the road, you don't have to think about it. You're not on stage thinking about playing and what you're doing. You basically stop thinking, because that's the whole point. You practice and you get to the point where you don't have to think. You stop thinking. And that is when you are totally in the now, as the catchphrase goes, where you're not thinking about the future, you're not thinking about the past, you're living in the moment and you're not thinking. And that's what you want to get to do with the mucus's diet. Practice the system, master the methods, the methodologies, understand the methods, and then eventually you forget all of that and you just go. Then you clean yourself up enough and your intuition can take over. And so that's why we kind of say, well, you know, really study the system, study these little details. And no matter where you are, where you're coming from, what you eat now, the transitional methodology can always be useful to you, whether it's, consciousness, transitioning your consciousness, because a lot of times that's a problem where people don't spend enough time transitioning their consciousness. So they worked on their bodies, but their mind is still stuck back in something else, and so the body is taken off, but the mind is still back in, like, you know, Chuck E. Cheese's or something. And I've seen people fall apart because they tried to push, on one hand, they were trying to push their physiology too far, and on the other hand, they never really undid some of their past addictions, and it came back all of a sudden. So that's why it's just that concerted effort of let's transition everything. You don't want the consciousness to get too far ahead of the physiology. You don't want the physiology to get too far ahead of the consciousness. Let it be. Let it roll together, you know, kind of let it be one, and bring these things back together. So anyway, that's the first bread craving. I'm aware of what some of the folks say coming from the Dr. Morris camp might say, well, just get into the parasite formulas and deal with the fungus and all that kind of stuff. That's all well and good, but that's not, I haven't seen that to be sort of this super cure-all in terms of mucus, because I don't know anybody that's been totally mucusless for like the past 5 years. Brother Air's been fasting for the past 3 months, so he's been mucusless for at least 3 months. But everybody I know is eating some kind of mucus forming food, whether it's an avocado or it's a piece of bread or it's like the toast, or it's starchy vegetables, or or some vegan processed food or whatever. Everybody's eating mucus at some point. And then yes, there's this folks is doing kind of like the longer fruit fast, and they, you know, and that's great, you know, because they're being mucuses, but I don't know anybody that's been able to step off and never return, just never come back. Like, I did this long fast, and then I never came back and ate any mucus. There might be a couple of people out there, and I applaud them, and I'm a fan, but I haven't seen it. Everybody tends to go back to some kind of mucus-forming item. So it's just about, you know, getting those days in where you are totally mucusless, you know, and you experience that, you know what that feels like, and you're like, yeah, you know, it feels good. My point with the parasite thing was basically, yes, you can cleanse yourself to a certain degree with some of those kind of formulas and certain green drink combinations, and you know, all that kind of stuff is there, but I haven't seen it be a cure-all for mucus addiction, because that always comes back sooner or later. With everybody that I've ever known, the mucus addiction comes back. And it's, like I said, it's, I don't like holding anybody back. So it's great if you can be the one person or the genius that never craves mucus ever again, and then you can just eat nothing but fruit and never that's beautiful. I just never seen it. I don't know anybody that's been able to do that. That's not what I'm trying to do. I'm not trying to break my back, you know, or try to push myself in that kind of manner. My thing is, let me do long periods of time where I am totally mucusless. You know, the longest where I've been 100% mucusless has been 9 months. And that was after I did a 6-month long fast, and then 3 months of transitioning back into cooked foods, or the solid foods. And then at a certain point, it wasn't like a huge mucus meal. It was probably, I don't remember exactly, this was years ago, so I don't remember exactly what it was, but you know, I just, at some point I eased in a little piece of mucus here, food, a little something here, just to make sure it would eliminate okay. And you know, some beans might've got in there or something, you know, but you know, green peas, and you know, that was a discussion people were having. They were talking about the lentils. And you know, my thing of that kind of down the middle transitional of that type of like starchy bean legume kind of thing is the green peas. I've found to eliminate well. They don't turn slimy. They don't tend to negatively react with the stomach acids to kind of create that reflux kind of thing. Overall, they eliminate well. They're less mucus forming, less starchy than like kidney beans or the black beans or something, that kind of thing. So just throwing that out there, because that was another question. And you say, also, what's good to eat for boredom eating? I mean, there's, you just explore your produce section. And if you see vegetables that you've never tried before, do a little research. And these days, everybody's got the smartphone and stuff, so you could be walking around the produce section looking things up on Google if you have your phone set up like that, or just go home and look at some stuff. But you can really explore. There's so much more diversity and variety in the plant kingdom than there is in the meat and dairy kingdom. The only reason people think that the meat and dairy kingdom has diversity is because they have developed so to this such a high level. I don't want to use the word art. fart. You know, if I'll be crude, but you know, they've developed the, you know, insert word of the of cooking. You know, they say the culinary the culinary farts. Why y'all make me be silly? But that's perfect though. But so the so they've developed over years, they've just developed all these ways to, like, let's cook the meat this way, let's cook, it's like the same filthy piece of pus, and they're just gonna cook it different ways. Let's broil it, let's put cayenne pepper, let's put paprika on it, let's do this with it, let's put a fried egg on it, let's do this, let's wrap it in bacon, let's, I mean, they just have endless, but it's the same handful of things. And they've just found what the variety is an illusion, because there's nothing, there's no variety to it. But in a plant kingdom, when you really get into exploring what's out there, there's a ton of fruits, there's a ton of vegetables, there's all these different ways that you can eat them raw or juice them, or certain, there's certain things that cook better than others. You know what I mean? So there's a lot of stuff to get into. And I know a lot of people, I'm getting the messages where people are like, well, where's your menu book? Where's the mucus menu book? And I'm working on it. There's a lot of stuff going on. And, you know, I'm finishing my own dissertation. And, you know, so I'm a busy guy right now. So I'm trying to get to it. But it's going to come out. And when it does, it's going to be solid. And it's going to be more than just a menu book. It's really going to lay out some explanation along the way of what to eat, why, when, you know, all that kind of stuff, just coming from my experience and my observations of dozens and dozens of people that have practiced mucus diet at this point. So yeah, so that is that. And also, you know, and again, I want to make the announcement, there's one more day for the GoFundMe campaign. This was a fundraiser to raise funds to be able to put out or to hire a voice actor to do the annotated mucus diet healing system. And again, I thank everybody for all your support. If you want to take advantage of some of the gifts that I will extend to show my appreciation, and you know, definitely get your donation in as soon as possible. Tomorrow is the last day when it's coming down, and there's some really valuable, you know, I just wanted this thing to happen, so I put some valuable stuff on there. The top gift, if you bought it regular price, would be like $135 or something, once you get the down all the downloads of all of the books in the Mucus Free Life LLC catalog, and you get the download the audiobook when it comes out, get a autographed copy of the annotated mucus diet, and then an hour-long consultation with me for $50. That's unprecedented, and that might not ever happen again. So that is something that, you know, that and a lot of people are taking advantage of that, you know, and so I'm real happy to see that. And I look forward to talking with everybody in the consultations. And I like that consultation vibe, because I'm able to, I have a questionnaire, and it's a short questionnaire, but I'm able to get all of the information I need with just a handful of questions. But once I have that information, I'm able to really give good advice, you know, really pinpoint, you know, transitional advice or healing, whatever person's dealing with. Yeah, it's something that I've been able to do in those sessions. That's a lot easier to do there than in a, you know, kind of the online forums and that kind of stuff. It's kind of like the online forums are good for the general information and getting that support from people. But when you want to go a little deeper and you really want to analyze, you know, what's going on, you know, because each person's transition is going to be specific to their body and their physiology. And one thing that I am fairly good at doing is kind of helping people create their own transitional approach, you know, to get off of, you know, to get to the next level of wherever they're at, whether it's, you know, I want to be more raw, or if it's I want to get off of meat, or, you know, whatever the issue is, then I'm, you know, I there's things to be done. You know, there's ways that we can make it happen. So the link to that is below. If you're in the group, you can find that. And I will be checking some to see if there's any questions. I haven't done it yet. Any questions that you guys ask, but I want to cover a couple more of these. So Jared asked, what's my opinions on the Gerson therapy? So, I mean, I haven't studied that super in depth, but I know what it entails, the main aspects of it. You know, there's a kind of a juice aspect of it, the fresh juice, and kind of a as Eric would call the camouflage fast. As with anything that has ever worked that I've seen in terms of some kind of healing system, there's always a fasting component that's basically like a camouflage fast. So there's the juicing thing and some of the stuff that I think there was the carrot juice thing was heavy, and I'm not really into that. So there's the juicing protocol. Then I'm totally against the nutritional supplement thing that I read about. That is not coming from the mucus's diet perspective. That whole nutritional approach is just not relevant. It's just we don't even have to look at that, because that's not what's going on in terms of how the body is at functioning and cleansing and reconstructing the glands in the system. If we want to talk about some of that, you know, you're dealing with fat. You know, the body is what heals itself. All we do with these tools, with the juices, and if we get into the herbs or whatever, or water, it's all about that fasting process, you know. But these tools, the enemas, the lemon juice enemas, those are just tools to help your body get out of its own way so that it can cleanse itself. You know, the other thing, the Gerson therapy, a lot of the coffee enema thing, which we're just against that and all. You know, we hate it when people try to compare coffee enemas to lemon juice enemas. They're nothing close at all. You know, coffee is already stimulating. It's already something that you would want to eventually get off of if you're, you know, a strict mucusless diet practitioner. You know, it's not a form of stimulation that you want to deal with, because look at the symptoms that happen when you don't get it. If you're addicted to it, if you're addicted to that caffeine, and I've seen people that practice the diet that, you know, if they don't get their coffee, and that's something that they're working on, you know, they might get a little jittery or something like that, you know, and it's like, not necessarily be the happiest of people until they are able to, you know, get the coffee. And I've seen now several different people. And so that's not something that if we don't want to drink it, his brother Eric calls it bean soup. He calls coffee bean soup. Yeah. The coffee beans and just taking them, and yeah, so that is, you know, you want to talk about, you know, people like to use the word innervation and stuff. I mean, that is gonna apply to coffee enemas with without a doubt. And I know on one hand it's supposed to sort of like stimulate stimulate things to get like the stones coming out and all that kind of stuff. And I just think if you're fasting, you're doing lemon juice fast and, you know, drinking lemon juice and water and doing lemon juice enemas and all that kind of stuff, though, any kind of stones or any kind of inflammation and all that kind of stuff is going to subside. Stuff starts to come out on its own. You know, you don't need to like overstimulate, you know, like with those liver cleanses and all that kind of stuff. You just don't need to do that. As far, in my opinion, you know, if you do it, fine, you know, great. And if you get out millions of stones doing that kind of thing, that's great. You know, that's just not something that I really promote. you know, or get in too much. So again, for me, it just comes back to the system. You know, I'm into the system. And so that's my thing. You know, as far as the, you know, the Gerson, there's a lot of kind of, you know, red tape there, that, you know, because anytime you have people that are trying to use medical terminology and say that what they do cures, you know, insert medical word, you know, or medical disease term, then you're going to get blowback. You're going to get all kinds of chaos from people saying, hey, it's this, and, you know, quack watch and all that kind of stuff. And so there's the folks down in the Hypocrites Institute down there. They just got him saying that he was out, I forget his name, but you know, I'd read about that article where he had, and they're going after him because he was using the C word and stuff. And so I just don't even get involved in that. You know, I'm you know, I work with people that have some of these medical terms, but I don't use them. I don't have to use them. And some of them are very happy going, dealing with whatever it is that they have going down this way. And, you know, so that's it. So you see me doing my verbal gymnastics just because it's a sign of the times, because there, anything that works, that's helping people, that's getting people away from the dairy industry, that's is having people take their health into their own hands, getting them out of the hospitals and all that kind of stuff, you know, they're going to be looking for you and sniffing around. And so my thing is that, just talk about health and, you know, human illness, you know, overcoming things that you want to overcome. But we don't have to get too deep into, you know, like Eret's method, which I use. But, you know, Eret's method is, okay, you look at what they told you have, but then there's always a mucus-free diet approach and explanation to whatever it is. So it can be useful, you know, if you get blood work done or something like that. I mean, I'll evaluate that. I mean, whatever you got, you know, if you got iris pictures, you got blood work, whatever. I mean, we can evaluate all that, but there's always going to be another take and sort of a transitional approach that can be modeled based on what you're experiencing. And then, you know, looking at some of that other stuff, but it's always comes down normally to constipation, cellular constipation, waste, all kinds of stuff, that a lot of things that can easily be dealt with just getting into the system. And then for the deeper, more chronic issues, I mean, there are certain things that are just not, that shouldn't be that big a deal, that have been made to be like boogeyman level stuff that just shouldn't be that big a deal. And it's unfortunate that a lot of the therapies that people, you know, that are considered to be mainstream and whatever, that people go after, that they end up killing you. And that's just having looked at statistics to see, well, how many people survive these therapies. They want to blame people dying on the disease, but I'm looking at these, you know, I'm looking at the so-called therapy that they're giving people, and then they fall out, versus people I've either worked with or seen other people work with that have gone this direction and have overcome, not overnight, it's hard work. You know, anybody that's going to tell you that it's easy and there's not, you know, that you don't have to be dedicated and it's not, there's not hard work involved, you know, I would probably run away from those people, because that's back to that you know, that those people give us a bad name, as far as I'm concerned, in terms of like that whole snake oil salesman kind of thing. Like, this is so easy. Oh, within 1 week, you can overcome this. You can lose 500 pounds and you can overcome your whatever disease. And this is like, anybody that's on that vibe, you know, run the other way, as far as I'm concerned. But if you're ready to kind of push up your sleeves and get on nature's operating table, then and kind of dispense with a lot of the hype and all of that kind of stuff, then this might be a path for you. You know, the it's complex in its simplicity, because that's what some people have trouble with Mucus's diet, is the simplicity, in terms of like, we don't have to get into analyzing a lot of chemistry and breakdown and counting things and all that kind of stuff. The nuance and what to me is more artistic than scientific is going to be the dynamics of the transition, because that's specific to each person. If it was the principles, could be, I could say that the principles are maybe scientific in terms of the methodical and systematic nature will always create a certain level of change, you know, but the art comes in where, you know, each person is going to be a little different, you know, experience is different, what they're going through, the little details, because they're coming from different things. They're going to have different cravings that they have to deal with, different emotional eliminations, different social dynamics. And these are all elements that we have to deal with. And that's what makes this thing more challenging in to a certain degree. But at the same time, it's still more simple. You know, there's a simplicity to what you're doing that sometimes makes these other elements in your life harder to deal with. Yeah, you know, because these other elements sort of revolve around, are kind of built to revolve around chaos, you know, and the pus and pus eating and stuff. Okay, so let's move right along here. Question about, are grapes with no seeds okay, and doesn't matter that they're organic? So here's my thing with the whole, you know, seed question and organic, and it kind of gets into the hybrid discussions, the hybrid vegetables and fruits and stuff. And here's my thing. You do the best you can with what you have access to and what you can afford. So if you can afford nothing but organic fruits and vegetables, and go, then that's all you should use. If you can only afford some organic fruits and vegetables, and then some other things you can resort to the conventional, then do that. And there's a handful of fruits and vegetables that are better, that you do want to get organic if at all possible, because of the way they're grown. A lot of the pesticides and stuff, like, you can't just wipe them off. They bleed into it, and you know, and grapes is on that list for me. My thing is, if I do get non-organic, I don't do it a lot, so I break it up. So if I really want something and they don't have it available in organic, but I see that it's available and it looks okay, in meaning it's not getting all moldy and nasty over there, then and I'll get it. But I'm not going to do that for a year. At some point, like, I want some organic grapes, you know. With apples, I've made the total switch to organic apples, where I don't even consider the conventional apples. But I use conventional apples for years. You know, Brother Air used conventional apples for years. So it's, again, like everything else, that was just a transition for me. It's been more recently where I've gotten deeper into the organic, where I've kind of demanded of myself that certain items I always get organic now. But then there's other things I'll still get conventional watermelons or oranges and, you know, things that kind of have that, that hard cover, some kind of cover on it. And you know, and kind of go by taste, because there's a lot of the problem. There's a, some of that organic fruit that you get at the store is terrible. It's almost inedible. There's no sweetness to it. I get some oranges that are organic, and I'm like, this is, it's acidic, it's nasty. Ugh, you know, and the conventional might be a little bit sweeter than that. So it's hard, but here's the thing. You know, and then back just to the no seeds. For us, it's about elimination. So we don't get real hung up on, you know, is this hybrid or not hybrid? Is this, like, we get hung up on, is this mucus forming, and does this eliminate well, and does this have the potential to help cleanse something? So I would rather eat, and I'll probably do another video on this, because this, I've been getting this question, and this comes up with the whole hybrid discussion. But, you know, I would rather eat mucusless hybrid vegetables than mucus forming things that are considered not to be hybrid. That's just mucusless diet consciousness. It's a different set of goals. You know, I don't know a lot of people that, you know, they people get real passionate about these little details. And oftentimes there's very few people that really adhere to that. You know, if you want to transition toward it, that's cool. But again, I would be mucusless first and then worry about the hybrid piece. Just in terms of priority, it's prioritize your transition, prioritize things to make your transition the most rational. Because everybody doesn't live in places where they have access to the greatest of organic fruits and vegetables, all that kind of stuff. If you have, there's nothing organic around, that's not an excuse to go eat meat. You can still transition. Eric talked about in the winter months, back before you had the 24-hour shopping malls and all that kind of stuff, to use the canned or jarred tomatoes and vegetables and stuff. And that would be heresy to some folks, you know, raw foodies and stuff, that have gotten so accustomed to 24-hour you know just sort of like the, you know, first world problems, you know, just sort of thinking that that's just the way it is, like just well, yeah, I got Walmart, I got Kroger's, you know, these 24-hour stores, you know, I have the co-op right next door, you know, they kind of get this attitude that, well, their life is easy and they got the money to buy all this stuff, and that's great, you know. But I'm saying that mucus's diet can be practiced on any budget, you know, in any part of the world, because, you know, you go down to some of the, you know, places that have less money, and there's still going to be, there's something that you can use that's transitional. That's there. And, you know, and I'm a fan of migration. So I'm in preparation right now to migrate to a more reasonable climate and a more reasonable ecology, because I care about my, you know, my health and my life, and that's what I'm into. But it's something, it's not something I'm gonna drop everything and just go. That wasn't my path. So I'm transitioning into it. Cause my thing is, by the time I leave where I live now and I move to greener pastures, I wanna be so much cleaner and physiologically on such a higher level. Like, I wanna leave a lot of stuff I'm working on now here where I live at now in the Midwest, in the United States. So by the time I move someplace, it's going to be a whole different thing. You know, physiologically, I just be on a whole different level. And then I'll be able to take it to new heights, because wherever I select, there's going to be a lot of great, you know, fruits and vegetables and stuff there. So at the end of the day, this thing is about survival. This thing is about, you do the best you can with what you have. And, you know, you're not going to get criticism from, at least from me, And again, that's what some people get so into. Oh, organic, you're going to die, and all this kind of stuff. And I'm just saying, just transition, do the best you can, what you can afford, what you do. And the shift is just making it a priority, you know, making it more of a priority to get better food, where instead of buying putting your money into the $300 or $400 iPhone or iPad or something that you don't necessarily need because you already have an iPad from 2010 or whatever. Instead of putting your money into that, you know, or big screen TV or whatever, you're putting your money into the food. So that becomes a shift of consciousness. Because it's kind of like where I go around folks that I know don't have a lot of money, but they'll have all kinds of gadgetry and all this kind of stuff. And then they're complaining about they don't have enough money for food. Like, well, how can you afford a laptop and the most expensive phone in the place and all that kind of stuff? You're not even thinking about that. So it's priorities, you know, prioritize. And so when you get deeper into this, you prioritize this. So that means you're going to do what you can do to get the better stuff. You know, I went for the first time in a while. I went to the wholesaler, and last time I was there at this particular wholesaler, I'd been going there for a couple years and getting stuff, and he didn't really have any organic. And then I left because I got deeper into organic stuff. And so I wasn't going to that wholesaler as much anymore. And then now I went back again just to see, you know, some stuff I wanted. I wanted to get me a box of lemons and see if the oranges were any good and stuff. And I went down, and it so happens now, because the demand for organic has went up, he's got organic now at the wholesaler. And I got a good relationship with him and stuff. So anything I want, you know, gives me a great price on, the markup is not much at all. I mean, in terms of, like, he'll give me a box of something and just take, however much profit, be like $10 or less, you know, something on a box or something, you know. So it's great deals, great prices. And so that's something, you know, that you want to develop a good relationship with a local wholesaler, and they'll take care of you. But that's my thing. It's about problem solving. There's not one answer that will solve everybody's problem. You know, it's, for me, it's more about having a survivalist mentality, like thinking differently. When you think more, some people like the show Survivor, you know, just the concept of being a survival. You know, people used to call me a survivalist, you know, 'cause I'm an Eagle Scout, was real big in the Boy Scouts and all the back, you know, the nature kind of stuff. And you think a different way, you know, when you're sort of trained to say, okay, what will you do if you're just thrown out in the middle of the woods with naked? What do you do? You know, a lot of people, they haven't even thought about that. They haven't even created a plan for what they would do. Because what happened if somebody just grabbed you up, blindfolded you, and then threw you out naked in the middle of the woods somewhere? You know, these are important skills that we should study, and the mindset that comes from that kind of survivalist thinking is important and can be applied directly to this process, directly to this transition. This is a deep, you know, kind of process. You know, there's this another version of a survivalist piece. You know, if somebody grabs you up and throws you in, a bad part of town, you know, a neighborhood that's a rough neighborhood, you know, can you survive there? You know, what kind of survival strategies do you have? You know, how, if you get thrown out on the street somewhere, you know, what do you do? I play music on the streets, and, you know, got introduced to that by Brother Air. And so a lot of people, you know, I'll be out there playing music. People think I'm homeless and all kinds of stuff. I don't care. I'm making music. Most people can listen to music and they can tell, like, well, something, this guy's a little better than whatever that. But a lot of people, you know, they don't know. But just being on the streets like that, I'm exposed to a whole different world, you know, in interpersonal relationships, and, you know, get to know homeless people, you know, and actually like, okay, well, what's the backstory? Like, what, you know, what happened in your life where this is where you ended up, you know, and you just learn a lot. And I learned a lot about survival because I'd already had the training to survive in the wilderness. Then I get the street training. How do you survive on the street? What happens if I was homeless tomorrow? I know exactly what I would do. And I'm blessed. I mean, on one level, I'm incredibly blessed because I have people all around the world that would let me crash at their place, you know, just as being a musician. And that's not even, you know, and then the music diet community. And I know I got friends all over the world. So I'm blessed because I've met a lot of people that do live on the street that, you know, they didn't have that kind of support. You know, they didn't have friends that had their back. They had to turn to the streets to find people to plug into. You know, some of these people are, you know, addicted to drugs. And so they have felonies and things that prevent them from, you know, getting in, doing school, you know, finishing school, having the money to finish school, prevent them from getting most jobs. And if you can't get most jobs and you're addicted to drugs and you don't, you know, you don't have a family structure supporting you and all that kind of stuff, then sometimes you don't really have any place to turn, and there's communities out there, you know, communities of folks that basically hustle and doing the whole begging and panhandling and that kind of thing, and you know, sometimes they get mad at me because I'll take all their, because I'm making music, and they'll and I'll be taking the money, I guess, that they think they should get, and you know. And I'm like, doesn't work like that. If you don't complain about the food trucks, don't complain about me, because I'm not, you know, I'm on a different thing. That's a church. That's a tradition. That's a historic tradition. The tradition of the street musician, you know, the street performer. That's a whole, got a long legacy to that, and a lot of people don't really understand it. But so anyway, that got interesting. Long discussion about survival strategies based on a question of should you buy fruits with or without seeds, you know. But that's an important point to me, you know, that developing that survival mentality and whatever that means to you, you know, being ready for anything to happen. You know, you got a tornado could come, you could lose your house, you could, like, you know, if you, what will you do? Be in a car accident. I mean, what will you do? I mean, I've thought about so many scenarios of what, and it's different from worrying, because I don't worry about any of that stuff at all. You know, it's actually a rational approach of a thought thinking process of just knowing what you would do, you know, knowing how you would think. If something was going down, and where there's nothing to be worried about, you know, because things are going to happen, stuff's going to happen, there's not a reason to be worried about the stuff, but you know, you just kind of think through scenarios and know what you're going to do. You know, if I was homeless tomorrow, like I said, I know what I would do. And with the Mucus's diet, that I find that type of mentality is very, very beneficial. You know, it's beneficial to understand that, get that. And if you grew up in a situation where maybe you never wanted for anything, and you've never necessarily been exposed to that kind of like hardcore survivalist type of thing, then you can, you know, put yourself around some people that have that they might not have anything to do with the diet, but they could be kind of brilliant people that have put themselves, or life circumstances have put themselves, in a certain type of situation where it's pushed them to become like that. You know, it's pushed them to be a survivalist, you know, and I love studying people that have, you know, hardcore attitudes and personalities, and they're real passionate about something. That's why I love, you know, artists, and I study the lives of artists and you know, great intellectuals and philosophers and scientists and all that kind of stuff, you know, and really is always their thought process and dedication to what they do always is real interesting to me. And you know, some athletes have that, you know, not all of them. There's still a lot of stimulation in that arena, but you know, there's some of those, you know. I have my periods where I go through all the documentaries and stuff, the athletic documentaries, and you know, get reminds me of the old football days. And that's actually all tied up in that mentality, because that's to me is what can be beneficial about the athletics. It's not really the whole physical thing and the competition thing, you know. I'm not really with the mucusless consciousness. I'm not necessarily a fan of that part of it, but that attitude of like go hard or go home, you know, applying that to the mucus's diet, I appreciate that. And I saw that that's what Brother Air did, and I could vibe with that. You know, I never forget being in the weight room when I was a varsity football player, and there was this coach. This was even before I got to varsity. I was younger. But there was a coach, and I used to like not like this coach, because he kind of came across as crazy, and he was hard on us, and it was just basically his military taskmaster type of dude. And I mean, he would go head to head with you. You had a helmet on, he had nothing on his head, and he would be like, and he would get mad at you and go head to head with you and hit you and hurt your head, and you got a helmet on. This dude was nuts. But he was in the weight room, and he was doing just like dozens of reps of heavy, just doing these bicep curls. And I think I was like, man, are you ever going to stop? And he just looked at me with this conviction. He's like, I'm never going to stop. I will never stop. I mean, and like, I was like, you know, but that kind of changed my life in a way, you know, just that moment. Cause it was like something clicked in me. Like that's what's needed. That unwavering conviction and that attitude. I mean, that was some attitude. I mean, he just, like, there was nothing that was going to get him to stop doing, you know, those reps, you know, and that kind of thing. Now, to me, it's not about like, okay, well, I'm going to go work out like that, because we don't, you know, we're not into that kind of thing in terms of that real hardcore, like bodybuilding, working out kind of thing. For most people practicing mucus diet, that's not a goal. That's not even something we want. You know, we want a natural body that, you know, you do your exercises, do your breath exercises, you know, do whatever feels comfortable to you. But we're not trying to be, you know, big, these gladiator looking things that are, you know, that's fairly unnatural looking from a nature standpoint. But just that conviction and that attitude of like, I'm never going to give up, I'm never going to quit, no matter what happens, no matter what comes, I will not be defeated. You know, that, I love that. That's my favorite part about my whole experience of years of playing sports. I mean, I played sports for years and years. You know, but that's the same attitude that I like in the greatest musicians that I idolize. It's the same attitude of I'll never quit, and of just greatness. Like it's you do the work to be great, put in the time, put in the energy, put in the work to be great. And that to me is why mucus's diet is an art form, because you got to put the time and the work and the attitude in it to be great. There's no scientific equation for attitude. See what I'm saying? Like art is all about attitude, the expression of the attitude to do what it is you feel you have to do, whether society supports you or not, whether your family supports you or not, whether your friends support you or not. doesn't matter. You will be sitting there by yourself painting. Might not have a dime in the bank, but you're happy doing what you know you have to do. You know, and that's just, that's attitude. That's artistry, attitude. You know, that you can't, there's not an equation for that. You know, how can you, social scientists have trouble talking about attitude, you know, for, people that write papers on phenomenology, they have trouble with that. And to me, as Brother Air would say, kind of get my back, this thing is about attitude. At the end of the day, this Mucus's Diet piece is about attitude. Because if you don't have an unwavering sort of conviction of, I'm going to do this thing, you know, I'm going to be rational about it. I'm not going to try to be extreme or do this or that. But I'm not going to let social things break my stride. You know, I'm not going to let, you know, all these other things become what's really challenging about this diet. You know, your friends and your family and this and, you know, I mean, you're dealing with your physical thing and your addictions, but all these other things start coming in. And that's what really makes this thing difficult, because you got to figure out how to navigate an environment that's not always at all conducive to practicing the Mucus-free diet healing system. You know, it, when you have a down the street, you got a McDonald's and you got a Kentucky Fried Chicken and all this kind of stuff. I mean, this is not really the greatest of environments to do what we're trying to do, but it's necessary. And that's not an excuse to not do what we're doing just because that is down the street. And the more, and what I've found is the more that we change and we change our consciousness and our physiology, the stuff that we need and the good stuff comes to us. Where I live at, there's two or three farmers markets that are within a couple miles of each other in the growing season. And when I started the diet, I didn't necessarily have something like that going on, you know. And so if you focus on the transition and focus on transformation of yourself and your consciousness, a lot of that other stuff, you can see it change. You know, you see restaurants closing up. I'll be driving by restaurants and being like, it's closed. Good for us. You know, feel like I had something to do with that, because it's, you know, it's the sign of the times. That's the change, and only we're the only ones that are gonna see it. You know, see that kind of thing. And so yeah, so let me keep on going here. Let's see this. We got a question about enemas, and they were kind of, you know, still having some issues eliminating, and that's been something I've been. A lot of people been working with, but I said, go, there's a couple videos I did on the natural mover, or the sort of the Eretz natural laxative. That's sort of like a first line of defense. If you're not regular enough and eliminating properly, I get into the dried fruit followed by juicy fruit. So something like the most aggressive one is going to be prunes. So you eat like 5 or 10 prunes and then follow it up with like 1 or 2 apples at the beginning of the day, and it should not create a real strong laxative. It's not like it's some unnatural laxative. It's just gonna start really promote good movement, you know. And so then later on, you have more fruit, or you have a vegetable meal, a mucusless vegetable meal, then everything should start moving on its own. So I would say, you know, just hold off if you're not having the natural bowel movements, and hold off on the enema for a minute. And let and work that protocol and get to where your body has that natural bowel movement. Then, you know, once it turns on, it's usually great, you know. But I'm just saying that in general, that's still another thing that I it's best if I work with somebody one on one to be able to give the advice that person needs, because I'm depending on what's going on, pancreas might be weak. You know, so we might have to talk about, you know, stomach and bowel formulas and pancreas formulas and that kind of stuff. But in a lot of cases, the arid's natural mover, the dried fruit followed by the juicy fruit, that works wonders. You know, if you're practicing the transition in the system and stuff. Sometimes if you're really constipated, then that's another thing. And in those cases, what I find is someone is just really constipated and has that real kind of caked on hard mucoid plaque and stuff in the system, then that's a little different situation. That's kind of like, all right, well, keep doing the lemon enemas and maybe up the dosage of the lemon juice in there. You know, really try to assail that, you know, that hard stuff. So, you know, so it's just a few ideas. But yeah, look back at some of the older videos. We talk about that quite a bit. This was an interesting one on the forum. It says, my kid really wants pizza. Should I let him have it as a treat? And I know this was answered by a lot of people on there, and there's a lot of different things for that, you know. And, you know, obviously you can do what you want, you know. But here's my thing with foods and treat. And this is just personal to me. I got away from using food as a treat, like to treat myself, it was just because it had such a strong addictive trigger to my old addictions. And so I kind of created a bad situation where if I were to do something good, then I would associate doing something good with eating something bad. And to me, that was like a mental problem that I had to overcome, because I had that, you know, every time, you know, like, okay, I get an A on a paper, let's go to the graders and eat ice cream. I do such and such. Let's go to the root beer stand and have 2 foot long chili, you know, cheese conies and a couple burgers, which is, I used to eat a ton of stuff, you know, and go there. But the thing was, I mean, I would eat that stuff even if there was nothing to celebrate, you know, but if there was something to celebrate, then maybe I'd get a little more to eat. You know, I go somewhere, go someplace special, but I pretty much had to just cut that out. I just had to say, okay, I'm not going to treat myself with pus and mucus. That doesn't mean that I'm never going to eat it, you know, but it's not, I'm just not going to eat it based on a treat. I'm going to eat it based on addiction, you know, craving it and wanting it, and then trying to find a way to find sustenance, you know, to kind of hit that addiction, hit that craving without being too, being too bad, you know, and that's a transition. So, you know, so that's just a thought. In terms of that, then there, you know, there's like the vegan pizzas, obviously, and people had suggested that. There's a thing that I used to do. I talked earlier about the Ezekiel bread tortillas, and I would have that tortilla, put some tomato sauce on it, a bunch of chopped vegetables, kind of some oregano and some other little thyme or something, some kind of salt-free stuff, and put it in the oven for maybe 10 minutes or something, and that actually helped me get off of pizza, because I was pretty addicted to pizza myself, and then I still wanted that thing, like I wanted that doughy kind of thing with something on it, it was kind of that combination of the bread, wheat, with cooked next to the tomato sauce kind of thing, but I found that really kind of helped, you know, that helped me get off of that kind of thing, and it wasn't something that I would eat that I would be. See, the thing is, you want to find things that are going to be less addictive than whatever you're craving. So that was much less addictive than just pizza, you know, just regular old pizza kind of thing. And I'd had a couple little, like the vegan pizzas and stuff there, here and there, but I never, I never gave myself the chance to really get too addicted to them. So I'd only had it like a couple times, you know, just kind of the beginning of the transition, just to explore what some of that stuff did. And, you know, but for the most part, transitional protocols really was getting me over those addictions. But, you know, but that's an interesting question. You know, do you reward somebody with some pizza? And you'll have to tell us what you ended up doing there. So let me check my questions and see what questions have come in, because I know that there's probably a few questions that have been posted, possibly. And let's see here. And we have a question from, bear with me a second here, please, while I open up my comments so that I can see all of them. And thanks, Andy. We got a shout out from Cincinnati. So much inspiration. Appreciate that. And we got a question from, let me go back to the beginning here. And okay, thanks for the e-friendship. Okay, that's something else. This is actually an older question. What's your thoughts and observations on raw apple cider vinegar? I'm not a fan. I'm not a fan of any of the vinegar things. Vinegar was one of the things that Eret was very much against. Eret was so much against vinegar that he would rather you have raw egg with lemon juice in a transitional mayonnaise than to have vinegar be in there, which I know there's some music folks that get into that and, you know, kind of promote the whole egg mayonnaise thing. I didn't use it. I don't really see the need in most cases to go down that road. You know, I think that you can be vegan. You can be vegan fairly quickly, you know, going along the mucus-free diet path, and you don't want to get lost in a lot of that kind of stuff. But as far as the even that, and then say, well, the apple cider, isn't that better than the white vinegar and all that kind of stuff? I mean, to me, it's all, you know, it's all acid forming. You know, it's pungent. Anything, because you wouldn't want to just drink. I guess some people do, but I wouldn't want to drink apple cider vinegar in this, like put it in a cup and drink it raw, like I want to drink some grape juice. You know, normally the apple cider vinegar, you know, you're combining it with something, or you're using it as some kind of, you know, like a condiment to make something else more palatable, you know, but to crave it, it's like, you know, it's just pungent, you know, it's got that, you know, kind of that little toxicity to it. And, you know, and I know a lot of people swear by it, and I used to do that. I mean, growing up when I first did kind of got into in high school, I kind of got into some things where I was taking these ginger root pills and this stuff. This was before I learned about the diet, and I was trying to lose weight. And I got into green tea. It was a combination green tea, apple cider vinegar, honey. And I was doing that because they said it was supposed to be healthy and all this kind of stuff and help me lose weight. Didn't help me lose weight at all. And I don't think it was all that healthy. So that's my thing. I'm not a fan of using vinegar for the transition. That's just me. I used vinegar in some salad dressings maybe for a couple months. But once I found that there's a couple store-bought vinegar-free salad dressings that are very good. Once I found those and I got into those, Brother Air turned me on to them. That's what his family used. Once I got into those, it was on. I was basically like, well, I don't need vinegar stuff. And then, you know, if you get into anytime you want to use vinegar, just use lemon juice. And it's going to be way better. It pretty much does that, whatever that thing that the vinegar does in terms of as a condiment on a salad or in a salad dressing or anything like that. The lemon juice is going to take care of that. So I would say with the apple cider vinegar, just kind of, if you can, steer away from it. You know, if you're into it at the moment, it's not the end of the world. Just like anything you're into, you know, it's just not something that I would plan on wanting to use as a transitional thing for, you know, as a staple. A lot of what we talk about is what should and shouldn't be a staple, because, you know, anything that you kind of get into on the outskirts of the transition is the transition. But there's certain things that you don't want to allow become a staple. And I would say vinegar would fall under that thing of don't let that become a staple. That's how I put the avocado in that. Don't let that become a staple. It's not the end of the world if you're addicted to it and you're eating it right now. You could be listening to this, eating it right now. I don't judge. I don't care. But my advice from Mucus's diet perspective is don't let it become a staple. You know, and so that's a lot of what we talk about is staple, like what's the best transitional thing versus, you know, so it's not a hard, where some people have those hard rules of, this is what you have to eat. And if you eat this other thing, then you are wrong and you're no longer in the group and all that kind of stuff. Like I said before, I don't get into all that, but in terms of best practices, you want to eat, you know, you want your staples that you're going to use for long periods of time, for months at a time or for years. You want those to be the best that they can be. You know, you want those to be on the highest level possible when you select the staples. And I call them the staples, you know, the stuff that you use every day for years, you know, for over long periods of time. You know, my staples are apples, even apples more so the oranges. I mean, I would say apples, grapes are, in terms of fruit, those are probably the strongest staples. And then under those, I, when oranges are good, you know, get the citrus in, and, you know, lemons are obviously staples in the vegetable world, spinach, green leaf lettuce, and celery are like kind of the ultimate staples that make pretty much form the foundation of all my salads. You know, and then everything else on top of that can kind of change. You know, sometimes I might have some green or red pepper. Sometimes I won't. Sometimes I might have cucumber. Sometimes I won't. You know, those are, they're there, but they're not staples. I don't feel like I can have my salad without that spinach. You know, it's kind of my foundation thing, but. So anyway, so that's my response to that. It was a question of, again, about the art of transition, menu, recipe. And like I said, I'm working on it. A lot of stuff going on, just real busy, but I hope to have that done. I would like to release it in the fall or the winter, next year. And so I know I keep pushing it back, because I know if you've bought Mucus's Diet last year or some of the older versions of it, it should already be out according to some of my older books. So I know that. I apologize for that, but you know, other things came up, and you know, and I do a lot of things, you know, just intuition of, you know, what's needed, what do I need to be working on right now, what's most needed, and that's coming around. You know, it's coming around to where I'm really seeing that that's going to be something that is very necessary to be doing, and for me to do and get into. So let's see, we got a question here from Van, and How do you feel about salt cravings? I've tried dulse and kelp, but they're not as satisfying compared to salt. Is salt frowned upon or detrimental on the mucus diet healing system? So yes, salt is another one of those items that we would put on the don't let it become a staple list. And so I see you are, you know, tried the dulse and the kelp thing, which is recommended in those things. But here's the thing with salt. I mean, again, I'll share the two takes on it, because you have Mucus's diet take, and then there's sort of the Dr. Moore's kind of take, you know, and I'm familiar with both. And so my take on salt cravings is a lot of that salt, as you start to clean yourself and you get away from salt, you notice that your mucus is much less salty. It's like more alkaline, you know, kind of more alkaline. And it has that less of a drying effect. You know, when I was going through a lot of eliminations early on, and my mucus was really salty, everything would be so dried out. If I was blowing my nose or coughing up mucus or whatever, just everything would be so dried out because it was like eliminating this salt stuff. Versus, you know, years into the diet and having been off of putting salt on things for quite some time, if there would be a tear would come down for some reason, you know, the tear would be not, you know, not salty. Sweat would be not salty tasting. Skin wouldn't be salty tasting anymore. And the mucus that would come out would not be salty. Now, if I eat something, I don't put salt on things, but maybe I might have, if I have something, you know, like I use that dressing or something like that, you know, there might be something that has some salt added to it. And so if I get into something like that, then I can kind of taste in my mouth, like later, you know, or if I have mucus elimination or something, I can kind of taste that a little bit of salt come out from that. And it never seems to be something that's good. You know, it doesn't feel like something that's helping me eliminate something. It's, if anything, it sort of dries things up. And, you know, it makes things not really flow properly, you know, because our body isn't made to deal with that kind of real, you know, isolated salt. You know, it's different with like mineral, they say like the mineral salts that Eric talks about, which is just like I say with people that talk about like the saltwater flushes, I'm like, well, just, I mean, I don't promote that and I'm not into that. My thing is, well, then just drink a bunch of celery juice. It's like the mineral salts in there, or eat a bunch of celery or something. I mean, you're going to get kind of a natural cleansing mineral salt process with that, versus, you know, kind of taking a bunch of this kind of the unnatural salt, you know, isolated salt kind of thing. And I know everybody has a lot of strong opinions about the different Himalayan, the pink salts or the sea salts and all that kind of stuff. Like I said, for me, the other reason that I wanted to get off of salt was it created a trigger for worse foods, because I had these associations with putting salt on bad foods. So in order for me to really get off of those bad foods, it was a good idea for me to get off of using salt. So, yeah, so that's kind of where we're at with that. Let's see. Let me check some of these other questions. Just checking to see if there was any other questions there. And okay, is this a new question? Okay, yeah, there is a new question. Let me refresh. Refresh this, and okay, Van forgot to add. Which type of green is best to use in the raw salad? to sweep out the impacted waste in the colon. I've been using baby spinach, but it seems as if something like kale, which is more firm and consequently probably more difficult to digest, would sweep better. Thanks. Well, yeah, I mean, you're right on it with that, because it's, yeah, something like the harder greens, I tend to not eat those raw. Like I would, if I eat those kind of, you know, I'm kind of a collard green man myself, but you know, I tend to always just steam those. But then the soft leaves are what I will use as the foundation of the salad. But Eric talks about the combination salad. So the key is combining the right things together. So for me, my favorite combination is baby spinach, a little bit of green leaf lettuce, and then chopped celery. So that chopped celery kind of gives you that you know, mineral salt rich, kind of a little bit rougher kind of vegetable that when combined with the soft baby spinach and the soft green leaf lettuce, you kind of have a bit of pulpy vegetable, you know, material that can eliminate well, relatively well, but at the same time sort of have a brooming, cleansing effect on the GI tract. And so, but those kind of things are, can be a little different for each person's physiology and each person's body. So that's where, as Eric said, and as we often say, that's where you want to try to find the foods that are the best for you. You know, the foods that eliminate the best in your body. So I told you what eliminates best for me. You know, everybody kind of finds their things that work the best for them. You know, you can kind of talk to different people and go on the forum and ask, you know, what's the best, what eliminates the best for you? And when you kind of get a lot of different people's experiences, you can try different things and then see what works best for you. But overall, that's the key, I think, is having the right, you know, the right combination will help to really create that sweeping process that you want. So that's what I recommend for that. Let's see, we got just a couple more questions that I wanted to get to here. And okay, one question I wanted to get to was from Jared about excess skin due to rapid weight loss on the diet. So here's the thing. Okay, so I weighed about 280 down from 305 after a little over a month on the diet, which is awesome, but I want to avoid the loose skin issue. I've been fat my whole life. So, well, here's the thing. You know, I went to the doctor one time and they told me I was 295. But I always say that I always say I was 280 because I know that I was 280 for an extended period of time. But I think I technically was heavier than that at one point. And by the time I got in the diet, I was probably closer to 300 pounds. And if I ever put in the time to go dig up my old medical records from when I was younger and, you know, and I think all that, some of that was, I looked into doing that at one point so I could actually have the proof. So, okay, this is how heavy I actually was. And then I go back and I find that stuff and then I'll change and start saying how heavy I actually was, because I think it was more than 280. But with that said, for me, you know, I lost 100 or 110 pounds over the course of about 6 months. But because I was doing it with the transition, with the mucus diet, it happened so gradually that there was some people that saw me all the time that really they could tell something was changing, but they didn't know what. And I always tell the story with my trombone teacher. He would see me weekly, but after I'd lost all the weight, he kind of one day came in and was like, "Did you lose weight?" you know, because it happened so gradually, and I never had a problem with skin, you know, like lagging skin or anything like that. And the key for, I guess, for to me was, you know, the enemas really helped, because keeping that colon cleaner really, you know, that was kind of like the whole, like the fountain of youth thing, as far as like just my, you know, I could tell the my skin got so much better, you know, and juicing all the time, eating the salads and just improving my diet, you know, it just sort of brought a youthfulness that I really didn't have, you know, because I started looking younger and younger from what I'd look like, and people to this day, my girlfriend said that I look like that in my old pictures when I was like 17 and 18 years old, that looks like my older uncle to me now. Like I look older than I even do now, like, you know, 12, 13 years later. And so I say that if you're transitioning properly, you know, you're cleaning yourself properly, you know, it's easy to that first 15 or 20 pounds is in the beginning is easy to eliminate. And that's easy to just, because that's, especially if you're doing enemas and stuff, I mean, yeah, and you start seeing this waste coming out, it's easy to get rid of 10, 15, 20 pounds of just uneliminated waste that's just sitting up in your body. And if you got any worms or whatever, it's, you know, so that's where you kind of get rid of that stuff real early on. Then you get to a point where it's going to slow down, you know, and you just keep the transition and don't really worry too much about the weight. Cause I knew I wanted to lose weight, but then when I would start talking about the diet with Brother Air, he'd be like, man, we don't even talk about weight. It's not even something we focus on. We don't weigh ourselves and stuff, you know, just, that's just not something of importance. And, you know, and I never know my exact weight. I know about what I am, I guess, but I might weigh myself two or three times a year. There's a place, there's a supermarket that I only go to every once in a while. And they have when you walk out, they have a scale. And so for fun, I'll jump on there and see, you know, see what I am or something, but it's just not something that I'm concerned about or really even worry about much. And I think that's a good attitude to take, because you take the focus off of weight and put it on the culprit of bad health, which is mucus forming foods. And you do that, and that sort of puts things in the proper perspective. And I think if you transition effectively, then, you know, there you shouldn't have issues with like, you know, the skin, the lagging skin kind of stuff. I also worked out. I mean, I worked out more then than I do now. You know, I work out every day and do different, you know, physical things, and, you know, get out, do kind of natural body movement kind of stuff and some of the aerobic exercises and things like that. But at that time, I did work out a little bit more because I was still coming from that other, you know, that other kind of athlete mentality thing. And, you know, and so I don't know if that, I don't know if that contributed any at all. But what I basically saw was the skin, the elasticity of it, it just sort of, you know, it just became natural. It just kind of sucked itself in. And, you know, so there, I just never had that kind of, you know, that kind of issue. And so that's that. And I think the final question for this evening is, well, this was more of an interesting discussion that took place, and there was a lot of people. This is on the forum, and this was Haley put up a picture, diets of people with the lowest risk of heart disease, and then they had like the, you know, the Maasai, the Kenya, and Tanzania. In fact, let me share. I will share that. with you. I'll share my screen so you can see the picture of it. Well, I thought I could do that little. Okay, there it is. I was gonna say I was going to try to make the transition a little smoother than sometimes. Okay, we're gonna look be weird here, I guess now. All right. Okay, I don't know what this looks like to you. I'm having this technical thing. It's making this picture look kind of strange. Let me see if I can put this in something else. So anyway, it's the Eskimos that eat a lot of whale meat, and you know, it's basically these indigenous peoples that have relatively long lives, or that's the argument, that here's a bunch of people that they eat in some cases one-sided meat diets, and so they eat kind of these one-sided meat diets, and then they live longer. And that's always the question. That's what the meat eaters and people that want to kind of try to defend their lifestyle will kind of, you know, have that whole perspective where they'll be like, well, meat is great. And look at all these people that, you know, they're having these real long lives, and you know, they eat nothing but meat and all this kind of stuff. And here's the thing: is first of all, with there's a study that's there along with it, and the study is kind of laughable. You know, all the different things they cite, they were citing some really old stuff from the 19 old studies that were just so outdated, and some of the studies were paid for by, you know, meat and dairy industry or medical industry and all that kind of stuff. And so whenever you're dealing with these studies, and that's the problem to me with when people want to say, well, let's rely on science, but like I say, read the structures of scientific revolutions by Thomas Kuhn, because you'll see that science is not what you think it is in terms of, you know, science is based on, you know, a lot of what we call science in terms of these theoretical things and concepts that sort of really color our perception of life and our paradigm. They often are problematic, you know, and they often change. They shift over time as people see things differently, new data is collected, and then you will have what's called a paradigm shift. And that's where the concept of paradigm shift comes from, that book, Structures of Scientific Revolutions. And the reason I get so excited about that book is because I'm interested in having a total paradigm shift. It's not good enough to just, well, I'm getting healthy and all this kind of stuff. I want to think differently, you know, and I would like to see other people have that kind of freedom to think differently, to say, okay, let's challenge these theories and think differently. You know, my point with these studies are that, first of all, a lot of these studies are very Eurocentric in nature, meaning that the focus is coming from a perspective of that Western ways of life, Western science, Western eating habits are supreme, you know, Western supremacy. The nutrition theory is based on that. The nutrition theories, you know, protein theories, vitamin theories, these were all based on people that thought that their way of life was supreme and was the thing in which everything else should be based on and compared to. So if you start from a perspective that your thing is already the greatest thing ever, and you develop an entire science based on that, if it turns out that your thing was not the best, if your way of life and your way of eating and your way of thinking was not supreme and actually the best thing, then it's going to be hard for you to reject all of that, to reject people's livelihoods. And they put their lives, devoted so much time and effort into writing these long treatises and these books and these theoretical texts and these nutrition things, and gone to school for 7 years and studied this stuff and all this. It's hard to put all that in the recycle bin, you know, and send that on out to the dump. You know, it's hard to do that. But that's one of those things that what we bring to the table is who's strong enough to do that, you know, and really challenge these concepts and, you know, take out to the trash what belongs in the trash once you see that it doesn't make any sense. You know, with these kind of studies, and that's why we always had to, we have to come back to the empirical knowledge, and meaning the experience. You know, like I said before, to me, science has failed us when it comes to chronic illness, when it comes to dietetics. Mainstream science has failed us. And so, you know, that was a discussion that came up on another video where we were talking about science. And even though Eric used the term science, you know, scientific method for regeneration, regenerating the body or healing, the word science has different connotations. And historically, science was used interchangeably with knowledge or with, you know, philosophy or something, you know, to have a scientific understanding of something understanding something as a science. You know, art and science were more closely linked together. And so, you know, Eric's using the term science more in the empirical sense of self-knowledge, of self-scientific understanding, which that context is not really what's used when most people use the term science today. You know, when people use the term science today, they're talking about, you know, a replicatable experimental process and systematic, you know, sort of testing process to get a certain kind of reading or certain whatever. You know, and even then that gets even more complicated because you bring in, you know, the humanities, the social science that'll try to use scientific methods to examine and understand social phenomena and culture and all this kind of stuff. So that's a whole other bag of worms. But at the end of the day, a lot of these studies are, you know, there's a conflict of interest. There's a vested interest when you have these, you know, cancer societies and disease, whatever, all these different that have no vested interest in really, quote unquote, curing anything. That's not how the people that are getting paid get paid. And so there's a lot of this money and all these different organizations that are just going into folks' pockets, and there's no advancements, there's no nothing, because there is no disease, you know, as Dr. Morris would say, you know, or his brother Air would agree, you know, say as well, you know, there's no such thing as disease in terms of that thing. So this is, they say, you know, lower risk of heart disease. But, you know, I just can't trust these kind of studies just anyway. But then other people were making other points showing that a lot of these numbers were problematic and wrong. And you look at one study in one scientific journal, and those numbers would be very different from another study. And historically, when again, when you look back, because what I didn't see any, they didn't talk about the islanders that have a mostly plant-based. I mean, this was a very one-sided article that was here. They didn't, if you're gonna talk about all of the indigenous peoples that eat a lot of the one-sided meat stuff, you know, you also talk about the plant-based peoples. You know, but it's harder to find information on them because they are, you know, I think to a certain extent, a lot of that is suppressed for a reason. You know, that's not, you know, like my dad grew up in Trinidad, and it wasn't until I got into the diet where I started hearing stories about people doing him doing 2 week long water fast and eating nothing but the mangoes off the trees for weeks at a time because they were poor. They couldn't afford anything else. And they might only had a little bit of meat, you know, once every couple of weeks or something. You know, it wasn't like an everyday kind of thing. So the islanders by default live much closer to, you know, historically speaking, it's changing because a lot of the KFCs and the Taco Bells and all those franchises are starting to really hit the islands. And so that now the islanders are starting to have the same diseases and the same eating habits and issues that that people in the United States or Europe or other places are having. But with my dad's generation, you know, they ate very much what was on trees and what, you know, what they could find if they didn't have the kind of money. And but nobody's doing a study on them. I don't see a study on islanders that are almost fruitarian, you know, or that are almost, and so some people say, well, then they must not be there, you know, and that's not the case, because you can go talk to, I know people, yeah, my dad knows, you know, he lived there. Dr. Morris talks about his case studies of when he'll have 90 and 100-year-old people that grew up in the islands that have very real minor issues, and they're that are fairly easy to fix with just going back to the way they ate growing up. And they'll be like, oh, well, that's just doing what I used to do growing up. But there's a reason that they don't get into those. And that's why it's that trying to rely on a lot of that scientific data is a failed proposition, because it is from the get go, the data is tainted by the, by a fallacious system of thought that's based on nutrition theories. It's based on, you know, it's trying to prove a certain kind of point. You know, and I could, I'd have to look it up. I think it's in their speech, but, there was a book called Food and Man that I used to quote, 'cause it kind of talked about just how people were plant-based eaters much longer than they were meat eaters and all that kind of stuff. And it was a standard, like it wasn't some people writing that had some kind of vested interest in promoting anything vegan or anything like that. Like these were medical people writing a history of nutrition. So they got way off into that's the book that I read when I want to read up on, you know, the Francois Magenti stories of the history of the protein theory and history of the vitamin theory. You know, it's all in there, in that type of book. And but at the very beginning of the book, it's what it's talking about. It's saying humans, based on archaeological evidence, humans were plant-based eaters much longer than they had ever been meat eaters. So I'm like, let's analyze that a little bit more. We never talk about that. People always start with humans as hunters and gatherers. Well, what about humans as gatherers? Because humans were gatherers much longer than they were ever hunters. But look at the priorities, just in the language, semantics, so much is in language, in analyzing and understanding language and why things are said the way they are said. Hunters and gatherers, which puts the supremacy on hunting, on the meat eating, the pus eating. Think about it, just that would be a paradigm shift, and that would change the context just to say gatherers and hunters. I mean, it's nuanced, but if you were growing up as a child and every time somebody said, instead of them saying hunters and gatherers, they were saying gatherers and hunters, it's saying that the gathering part, it was much more important further back than the hunting part. And then based on the archaeological evidence that the humans didn't really eat meat that long, then you could say gatherers, you know, before hunting. And there's a lot of, you know, it's only so far that I'll even get into that discussion, because then you start getting into the discussions of evolution and degeneration and all that, and that's you know, that discussion is for another time. Embryology and all that kind of stuff, and the, you know, new theories of what's really going on physiologically, and won't get into all that right now. So anyway, that's kind of my piece on that. Basically these studies are just flawed. I mean, they're gonna be flawed. You can read them, you can check them out, you can see if you can, you know, make a little bit of stuff here and there. But like Eric said, you know, most of these people aren't gluttons, and long life for me, that's not the top goal. That's not why I practice a mucus diet. Like, I don't practice a mucus diet with, in my mind, everything revolves around long life. Like, oh, well, you know, I'm 100 years old or 120 or 110 or, you know, whatever. Like, that's not at all how I even think about why I do what I'm doing. I mean, that's just, you know, that it's kind of like talking where the discussion before about weight. You know, I didn't think about weight. Once I really got into the system, I wasn't thinking about and worrying about losing weight. I knew that if I just stayed with the system, it was going to take care of that. So I'm not worried about trying to look at what people's live long and all this kind of stuff. I'm into the system, and the system is going to take care of all that. And if I make it, I make it. There's going to be collateral damage, and everybody's not going to make it. You know, just in general, in whatever people getting into or whatever. And you're always going to have these examples of people that, you know, do Dr. Pepper fasts. Live on Dr. Pepper for a year and end up being 110 years. I mean, there's going to be examples of these things that people get too overzealous and excited about these kind of things. We're like, well, so-and-so ate such and such and they became 120 years old or 110 years old. And it's like, okay. But did you also notice that a lot of them outlived their children? Where her children died in their 50s or their 60s, and they were still living. They were the oddball one that just physiologically sort of had their body develop the ability to deal with pus and mucus. And in this society that's based around pus and mucus, those people are revered. Those people are put on pedestals. But what that represents to me is filthiness. Like, who's filthy enough to withstand the worst of the worst eating? You know, see, again, paradigm shift, because now instead of looking at being sick as something bad, of something that you know, some kind of like, oh, that person's sick all the time, I'm looking at that person saying, well, that person's got a little bit of health in them, because their body's not letting them eat terribly. their body's basically saying, whoa, you got to stop this dairy thing. Doesn't work for me. You know, this meat thing doesn't work. You know, the body is forcing them to stop eating a certain way. And to me, that's a sign of cleanliness. I mean, that's a sign of a certain level of, you know, your body is just gotten to the point where it's done. It's not going to let you degenerate it that much with impunity, because you're either going to get it together or you're not going to be permitted to live in that body for a long period of time and defile it like that. You know, and that's not the case with it. So, you know, I would rather have a body like, and that mine was kind of like that, where I, as bad as I ate, I paid for every bit of it. You know, I paid for every bit of morsel of filth that I ate, and am still paying for it. You know, and that's the thing that you got to be prepared for on this path, is we are paying reparations for everything that we did that is diametrically opposed to nature. And although you can look at some of the indigenous peoples and this stuff that, you know, might seem to have a little longer life and eating a certain thing, there's so many other factors involved in terms of, you know, most of them aren't gluttonous. A lot of them don't have the same kind of, you know, like kind of stress and things that we dealing with. You know, it's just a whole different reality. But it's just not the whole picture, you know, not really understanding that those are people that are transitioning physiologically further down, you know. So at the same time, their body is getting more used to eating worse. You know, worse foods, but it's, you know, as they say, genetically, you know, just over time, the degenerative diseases and things, the chronic illnesses, being born with, you know, really, really bad issues, you know, that's getting worse and worse, you know. And it's like, you know, Brother Air would say, you know, you used to be in Africa, you know, you'd have a pregnant woman that'd be out and about, and then be like, okay, I'm about to have the baby, go off and, you know, squat down and have the baby, cut the umbilical cord, and then could go back to work or go back about their day, you know. And but, you know, in our situation, we're so constipated and taking ourselves physiologically down the rung that we had to create these huge institutions and hospitals and have all this apparatus and all of this sort of emergency situation equipment to have a baby. Something that's supposed to actually be fairly simple in a cleaner body is been exacerbated, and has been like just this danger. Everybody's at jeopardy, danger. The baby could die. The mother, you know, because before that there was a lot of mothers dying, but that's not natural. That's not the way it's supposed to be. So people look at that as progress, like, well, you know, we don't lose too many mothers anymore. You know, those back in the day, they used to. It's like, no, back in the day, you didn't go far enough back in the day, and you're not looking at the right places and the right people that had it together on a higher level. It's hard, you know, it gets real hard, because anytime you're talking about Africa, you know, you're talking about post-colonial Africa. Anytime you're talking about Native Americans, you're talking about post-attempted genocide and taking people and moving them, you know, totally disrupting the way that they lived and what they were doing, putting them on a reservation, putting one that might have lived and adapted to this area, and move them up north, and move them down south, or that kind of stuff. Totally disrupt everything, all over the world. You know, disrupted indigenous peoples, and it's very hard to get a real sense of what, you know, of what that's like. But at the end of the day, everybody is just in a different transitional phase physiologically of in this pus and mucus world, you know, in this pus and mucus game of, you know, some are a little higher or lower on the ladder than others. And, you know, and it's just sort of what do you want? You know, which, you know, what level do you want to be at? You know, do you want to just have, you know, to take your chances and go down the whole meat world mode and just do the, you know, kind of, you know, deal with the mainstream thing, you know, go down that road of, you know, it's what everybody else does. And, you know, if everybody else is doing it, you know, it's hard to do that. Once you know that you don't have to go through a lot of those illnesses, it's hard to choose that road. I think it's harder. But that's the thing. I mean, we have the option to choose, you know, one path or another path. And, you know, I think it makes sense to me to try to get ourselves together, you know, it's just not about me. You know, I want to be able to, you know, pass this on to other generations, you know, down the bloodline, you know, try to clean up my bloodline. And that is, you know, that a lot of people, they're so into like, well, me, I want to do this. I want to be mucuses. I want to be, you know, long, fast, and all that kind of stuff. It's like, but what about transforming yourself so that when you have a child, that child is on such a high level, you know, and then when that child has a child, you know, by the time we get two or three generations in to mucus's diet practitioners, you know, look out. I mean, this is going to be a whole different level of humanity, whole different level of health, vitality, physiology. You know, they'll be looking back. They'll be looking back at these discussions like, oh, well, that this Professor Spira discussion, that was so quaint back then. You know, they were so cute trying to get themselves together. I mean, their thing is going to be on a whole different, you know, just walking on water levels, you know, just levitation type of, you know. So I'm interested in that, you know, like it's like I want to take myself as far as I can go. You know, but at the same time, I would like to develop something that I can, you know, a bloodline that can be passed on that's on a higher level and let that do something. You know, but that's years away. You know, that's not something I'm thinking about, you know, and, you know, looking at now. It's like I got to clean myself up serious. And I'm not talking about a couple years or this or that. I'm talking about like, you know, let me get 30 years under my belt, 40 years of real hardcore transition and cleansing and long-term mucusless periods and all of that, you know, and then let's, you know, let's try to create something that's cleaner than me, you know. And so, as always, it is a privilege and a pleasure to talk with all of you guys here, and as always enjoy doing any kind of discussion where there's folks that are plugging in, and I hope that you are you know, that you guys get something out of these conversations. And you know, I really enjoy you know, sharing my experiences, a little bit of knowledge that I have with other folks. And like I say, each one teach one. You know, you learn this stuff, experience it, then you pass it along, you know, pass it on to somebody that you love and care about, and that's willing and open to hear the information and go down this path, you know, go down the path of healing, the path of self-transformation, of worldwide evolution. And, you know, I truly believe we can clean up this world. We can get ourselves together and you know, just bring a whole different level of consciousness into this world. And so as I close off one last time, I will tell you about the GoFundMe fundraiser here that we got going on. It's the last chance to show your support and make the donation. Like I said, we have far exceeded the original expectations, you know, and I just, you know, I love every one of you that are really helping out and making this a reality. You know, Mucus's Diet audiobook is going to be, it's going to be wonderful, you know, just to have that and be able to, you know, people that don't feel like reading and all that stuff, you know, we're going to, there's going to be no excuse, at least for the English speaking world. There's not going to be any excuse. And so the gifts again, basically are, you know, the thank you for helping, a $10 donation, you get a free download of the audiobook when it's done, $20 donation, free download of the audiobook and download of the entire Mucus Free Life ebook catalog, $35. You get all of the above plus the free hard copy of the annotated Mucus Diet autographed by the annotator, which is myself, and then $50 donation, all of the above plus free consultation with me. And you know, that $50, the thank you gifts of the $50 donation pretty much would be about $135 if you just bought it separately, all those things, and then the autograph, that's only in special occasions. So I would you know, and I was willing to do that just because I really wanted to, I just really wanted to make this happen. And I'm also excited to talk to everybody, you know, to talk to folks that have maybe wanted to have a consultation or talk with me, but couldn't necessarily swing the normal price or something. And, you know, just saw, well, here's an opportunity to help out with a good cause and also, you know, get a little bit of feedback on what you're trying to do physiologically. So it's a win-win for everybody. So this will be active for one more day through tomorrow. So anything that you can do to help, because at this point, you know, we got the money for the production. Now we're working on some of the money to be able to really advertise properly, you know, put it out there, the whole, you know, marketing, production stuff, you know, all of that, you know, takes a lot of funds. And there's, and everywhere you turn, there's fees doing certain things. You know, you try to get people to that are good at, you know, the marketing, you know, everybody has to take their piece of the pie. And it's and up to this point, I've done all of that myself. You know, I've had no, you know, I don't have a lot of money. You know, I'm a PhD student and musician, and you know, taught was a you know, adjunct professor and stuff for a minute. But you know, I'm just like, we're, you know, the people that's behind this whole movement are not people that have, you know, a ton of money and stuff. You know, this is just, it's passion, you know, passion project, and we feel like we have to share this information, because if we don't, then nobody else is gonna do it. And then we have something special and necessary to share with the world. And so, you know, for years, it was Brother Air. He was the one that was out there promoting things, you know, and I kind of, it's been my turn, you know, so I'm kind of doing what I can do in this internet age, you know, the technological age and stuff. And then at some point, somebody else will come along and they do what they do. And this is how this knowledge spreads. This is how people learn. People understand that this thing is real. That it's possible to do it rationally. And you know, this is just how we do it. You know, you just put the word out there and really be supportive of people that are trying to do it, trying to get themselves together. So I don't know if you were able to see that or not now that I went back, but we were looking at the GoFundMe page. At least I thought we were. So sorry if you were looking at a black screen there. So so I will wrap it up. Again, I thank you so much for tuning in and hanging out with me this evening. And we will be doing this again real soon. Until next time, peace, love, and breath.